What are we doing, folks? Your host Moose here on the Pitt Panthers Football Network as we welcome you to our Season 6, Week 2 around the NCAA Recap Show. Your Pitt Panthers opened the season disappointingly with a 41-31 loss in Knoxville to the Tennessee Volunteers. A tough day for the Panthers. Davion Reynolds, a breakout star as a true freshman, but unfortunately, the quarterback position, a real area of weakness for the Panthers. 5 turnovers overall, a brutal day on the field, and of course, a 24-point second quarter for Tennessee allowed them to take a big, big lead. Pitt battled back with a late touchdown, ended up scoring 17 straight points, but allowed Tennessee to have 2 pick sixes on the day en route to the 41-31 victory. You take away those 2 pick sixes, and it's a tight battle. And if anything, you could argue that the Panthers outplayed Tennessee. Yardage-wise, nearly 200 more yards of total offense. Very, very solid on third down. Held Tennessee to 2 of 10 on third down conversions. It was just a matter of making mistakes from the quarterback position. A couple of them probably you could lean on some receivers for not coming back towards the ball, especially the second pick six, the Jay Ballmer. Should have caught that one, to be honest, and as well as it should have been ruled out of bounds. But either way, mistakes all around in the passing game in that regard. CJ Kirk, AC Reese, both of them over 130 yards and a touchdown, multiple interceptions for each player. Where Kirk added a bit more value was he ran for 47 yards on 9 carries, did a nice job there. AC Reese only added 8 yards on the ground. Davion Reynolds led the way with 49 yards and a touchdown. Jay Keys also had a touchdown run, though he didn't do much more otherwise on the ground game. CJ London really struggled, 8 for 14. Receiving wise, Reynolds, of course, was great out of the backfield, 3 for 57, including that huge 35-yard touchdown. Paul Lease was very solid, 5 catches for 62 yards. Jay Keys, a usual stat line for him, 6 catches, 74 yards, and a touchdown. If anything, it was a light stat line, but, you know, owing to the inconsistency of the quarterbacks, you know, that is to be expected. But only 1 drop for the Panthers on the day, so when you see the number of incompletions they had and the number of interceptions they had and just 1 drop, that tells you that it's an issue in terms of the quarterback play typically, as opposed to the receivers causing issues for his signal caller. Jalen Hills did get a sack for the Panthers. Interception-wise, Pitt was able to create 1 turnover, but Calvin Carlson very early on, but the defense was okay. They didn't play spectacular. They didn't force a ton of turnovers. They didn't get a ton of sacks. They didn't get constant pressure on John Gooden. But they did hold Tennessee to 2 of 10 on third down. They kept them into some field goal situations. And they did a nice job limiting the damage really as much as possible. It was just a matter of they were put in such terrible positions. And the fact that really when you look at that scoreline, 41 points for Tennessee, but it's only 27 given up by the defense because 14 of them came on pick sixes. And then you figure in 27 points, how many of those drives that Tennessee scored on did they get the ball in the Pitt half of the field and things of that nature? So either way, it's a game Pitt has a lot of things to clean up moving into Week 3. Around the ACC, though, North Carolina, Florida State, Louisville, all victories over FCS schools, although Florida State and Louisville probably a bit closer than they would have liked. Near upset alerts for those top 25 teams. Virginia Tech blows out Wyoming. Stanford, a tight victory over Virginia, 31-26. Pretty solid game there. Army continues their domination of schools with a 56-0 drubbing of the Duke Blue Devils. That Army rushing attack is just unstoppable right about now, and they're racking up the yards. Wake Forest does get into the winning books with a victory over Tulane, 34-31. Alabama, an easy victory over NC State in the Chick-fil-A kickoff game. They get back on the right track after being blown out by Georgia. They do their own blowing out and smoke NC State. Rutgers pulls one of the upsets of the week, knocking off Miami, a team that had ACC championship aspirations, and they go down to the Scarlet Knights. Huge victory there for Rutgers. Ole Miss 42-23 over Georgia Tech. And the story of this game, Dustin Young, the Ole Miss quarterback, 3 passing touchdowns and 3 rushing touchdowns. Incredible game for him. Syracuse gets a victory, just barely escaping UNLV. Clemson, a fairly comprehensive victory over Notre Dame, 30-14. Where they're going to likely maintain their number 1 ranking in the country. Around the top 25, UCLA with a win, Oklahoma, a lot of FCS opponents, of course. Colorado, upset of the week, knocks off number 10 Cal, 41-31. Huge win for the Buffaloes. Gets them into the victory books for the first time this season. And Cal, after such an unbelievable year last year, a real fall from grace there. We'll see if they even stay in the rankings following that loss. TCU nearly upset by an FCS school. Houston has their way with an FCS opponent. Florida beats Texas A&M, and this is a ridiculous game. So Florida ends up winning 24-21. Texas A&M, 6 turnovers to Florida's none. Clint Franklin, we talked about him as possibly the best player in college football, the quarterback for Florida. He threw for 130 yards on 9 of 25 passing. There were 14 red zone trips in this game and only 5 touchdowns scored. Texas A&M, 6 turnovers, 5 interceptions, just a ridiculous scoreline allowing Florida to get the victory in a top 6 battle. Oregon ends up beating Penn State, uses a pick 6 in the fourth quarter to come out victorious 35-31. Transfer quarterback Al Dingle passing for 215 yards and running for 60 and a touchdown in the victory. Tyree for Penn State, great game for him, 180 yards and a touchdown in the loss for the Nittany Lions at home at Beaver Stadium. And West Virginia, it's a day that if Pitt fans are going to be, you know, sad they lost, at least they'll be happy both of their rivals lost as well. Penn State goes down, and West Virginia, after a great season last year, falls to Iowa 34-17 in Morgantown. So a rough start to the campaign for the Mountaineers, trying to build on their 11-2 season last year. Texas ends up being USC 43-24, I believe. And Javonte Perry comes out. I'm not sure if it was due to injury to Kelly or what caused him to exit the game, but Javonte Perry, a true freshman, one of the guys that was a top-tier recruit that was brought into the game, 2 touchdowns and over 160 yards passing in relief. Great performance from him. And is there a quarterback controversy now in Austin? It remains to be seen. Oregon State wins. Washington wins. So some big wins for the Pac-12 in some late-night action to round out the top 25 in week 2. And because of those games, we have a new number 1, which I don't actually agree with, to be perfectly honest, in the coaches poll. Florida, because of the fact they beat number 6 Texas A&M, jumps up to number 1. Clemson after beating number 22 Notre Dame. I thought their win was more impressive. Florida looked terrible, only won because of so many mistakes by Texas A&M. Either way, Florida is now number 1 in the coaches poll. Clemson falls to 2, Houston back to 3. Houston, I don't even think they should be in the top 10 based on their team, but it is what it is. We'll see how things shake out for them. Texas A&M falls back to number 10. We can see we fall back to number 14 after our loss to Tennessee, who comes into the rankings at number 19. South Carolina jumps up to 13. Oklahoma's up to 8, so a big jump for them. Tennessee into the polls at number 19 after their victory over your Pitt Panthers. Georgia up to 21 after a bye week. They'll have a big game this week against South Carolina. Penn State, with their loss to Oregon, falls back to 23. Notre Dame back to 24. Stanford into the polls at 25 with their victory over UVA. And you can see Cal and West Virginia both dropping out of the top 25 following their upset losses in week 2. Miami of Ohio, Cincinnati, Arkansas State, some teams like that creeping towards the edge of the polls as it stands right now. And I mentioned huge games around the country. Eric Washington, outside linebacker for Kent State, 3 sacks, a pick, 6 tackles for a loss, 14 tackles, and a win over an FCS school. Still an incredible game. And Dustin Young, Heisman favorite along with Clint Franklin of Florida, 3 passing touchdowns, 3 rushing touchdowns, over 360 yards of total offense. Great game for him. In the ACC, Nicholas Foster of Clemson forced a fumble and recovered a fumble, while Travis Huff, the senior quarterback for Virginia Tech, over 300 yards and 3 touchdowns in the Hokies' victory over Wyoming to earn ACC Player of the Week honor. So some really strong performances this week. And some other ones around the country, I just wanted to show off. Isaiah Russell of Washington, 5 touchdowns and over 150 yards of offense. We already mentioned Dustin Young, and a guy to watch out for, true freshman Dane Poe, just a standard true freshman, gigantic game for New Mexico State, almost 400 yards of offense for the true freshman in their victory. Huge injury news. Caden Mitchell, we talked about him as possibly the best halfback in college football. He's a true sophomore, was going to be a star for Purdue, still will be a star for Purdue. 97 speed, 94 overall. He's an unbelievable player. He's going to be out for about 10 weeks with an injury, so that's a huge loss for the Boilermakers, who I thought were a dark horse in the Big Ten this year. ACC matchups to come in week 3. Duke will go to Illinois to take on Northwestern. Evansville. You'll have, or Evanston, Evansville, Evanston, Either way, Florida State, Georgia Tech in a big ACC battle. Syracuse, FIU, Clemson will have a nice reprieve against the Citadel. Virginia will go to South Bend to take on Notre Dame. Minnesota will take on NC State. Kentucky will take on Louisville. Huge rivalry matchup there. Texas, another big game against a solid team in Miami, although the Hurricanes, of course, looking to rebound after their upset loss to Rutgers last week. Boston College will take on TCU, looking to put the Horned Frogs on upset alert. Akron will take on Virginia Tech. Wake Forest will take on San Diego State. So a pretty full slate of games in the ACC for week three. Around the top 25, Penn State will go on the road looking to rebound. They'll take on Southern Miss. Oregon will host Bowling Green in a non-conference showdown. Virginia, like we mentioned, will take on Notre Dame. That should be a fun matchup. Both teams coming off of losses. Notre Dame, the more talented and likely to win there. Louisville, Kentucky, a great rivalry game. Kentucky actually beat Auburn in week one, who's a very solid SEC program. Kentucky's offense looked very good. We'll see how that goes up against Louisville here in this week's slate of games. Stanford will take on Utah in a Pac-12 game after getting into the rankings. Huge game in the Pac-12, arguably the game of the week. UCLA, Washington, this is a game that so often features into the Pac-12 championship race. They seem to play each other every season, be it in the crossover for Pac-12 conference games or in the Pac-12 championship game itself, and it's slated to be another doozy in Seattle. I like UCLA in this one. Herb Street likes Washington. We'll see how it plays out. Texas, like we mentioned, beat USC last week. They'll play another blue blood this week in Miami. Should be a great matchup. We'll see if Javonte Perry features at all for Texas, the freshman quarterback who played so well for them last week, going up against a Miami defense that was atrocious against Rutgers last week. Alabama against an FCS school. Florida will host South Florida, looking to get their offense back on track after struggling against Texas A&M. Vandy, currently at 2-0, will take on 2-0 Ole Miss and Heisman contender Dustin Young. SMU will take on North Texas. Georgia will head away to Columbia to take on South Carolina, a team that's always good. They were in the SEC championship game last year, of course. Georgia coming off a huge victory over Alabama and then a bye week last week. Carter Ford at quarterback, a number of great players. Travis Morris, arguably the best receiver in the country. They're looking to have another big game. And I mean, this is a game everybody's looking forward to. LSU versus Oklahoma. You got two of the best young quarterbacks in the country, Taylor Savage for Oklahoma and Kawano Kelecolio for LSU. Going to go head-to-head, two spectacular offenses. Kelecolio lit it up for LSU last week. Savage managed the game for Oklahoma and led them to a victory. I think this is going to be an incredible showdown. Two teams with immense levels of talent. That game's going to be a lot of fun. And then you have an SEC battle, Tennessee, Texas A&M. Of course, A&M coming off that loss to Florida. They do have a win this season. I'm forgetting it too, but I'm pretty sure it was a ranked win as well. So they've had a tough slate of games to start the season off. Tennessee, of course, 1-0 after a victory over your Pitt Panthers. They look very good. Turnover differential will be key here if Tennessee wants to win, because Texas A&M turning the ball over at will against Florida last week, Tennessee taking the ball away at will against Pitt as well. So if they can both keep that streak up, I think it'll be an easy win for Tennessee. And finally, your Pitt Panthers will take on the Temple Owls. Both teams lost their season opener and will come to Heinz Field looking for their first wins of the season. I think the Panthers should be favored here. They're the more talented squad, but they really have to figure out their woes. That turnover differential, you see Temple did force had a plus two turnover differential despite the loss. If they can keep that up, put themselves in good field position, they'll make things a lot tougher on the Panthers than they need to be. The real question mark for Pitt, who's going to start at quarterback? I would expect it to be A.C. Reese, but more than likely he'll have a shorter leash than normal just because of the fact that he struggled in week one. C.J. Kirk did offer a nice bit of explosiveness. I think both quarterbacks could see time here in this game. For Temple, Keegan Bentley, the redshirt senior at quarterback out of Lodi, New Jersey. First year as a starter, and he left the game last week with an injury, hence the fact why they probably lost, to be honest. Jeff Scruggs had to come in, really struggled. You can see 28% completion percentage. He was terrible. So Keegan Bentley, if he can stay healthy for this game, it's going to make things a lot easier for Temple. Scruggs, actually, Western PA guy. You can see they're from Baldwin. And there will be a lot of that on the Temple roster. You'll note it as we go through a lot of Western PA guys sprinkled throughout this Temple team. They're starting running back Desmond Archer. He's lightning quick, 95 speed. I think he'll be very dangerous, a guy we'll have to watch out for. They have Gervonta West as the backup as well. Solid player, good contributor. So they have two decent halfbacks that can move the ball if they need to be able to do so. Fullback, they actually have a solid player, Aaron Wilson, impact player from Monroeville. So again, a Western PA guy, Pittsburgh guy. He's very good. We'll see how much he actually gets the ball. I don't know how much fullbacks usually get it, even if they're good. In the sim engine, they do, but in the game engine, they usually don't. But he's a very good player. Barrett Phillips, solid receiver for Temple. Of course, 99 speed, the California boy, of course, named Barrett from California. Makes very good sense. Marvin Burnett, Philly area guy from Radnor Township. Cody Pollard from Hampton. So Pittsburgh area guy. A lot of PA talent. Of course, Temple is a Philadelphia area school, so you'd expect to see a lot of those. New Kensington guy, PA area, or Pittsburgh area. Then you had a University Park guy, so he couldn't get into Penn State. So basically all these guys that couldn't go to Pitt, couldn't go to Penn State, they end up going to Temple, and you see them on this roster here. Leslie Brown, the tight end. Jeanette, again, Pittsburgh area player. Wayne Hammond. Their line is solid. Leslie Williams at center is very, very good. It's a shame for Josh Morris that he's the backup center because he'd be starting at any other position on this team. But their offensive line is actually all very good, 80 overall or better. And that's the one thing you'll notice with this Temple team. It's hard to find a specific weakness for them. Honestly, their defensive line is probably their biggest weakness. They have some, you know, mid-70s to low-70s rated guys in the middle, especially at defensive tackle, Itrez Walton, things of that nature. Beyond that, they're pretty solid. They have 80 pluses everywhere on the field. They don't have any real weaknesses. I think they're actually going to be a very, very tough opponent and one that we don't want to overlook, especially after having such a poor game last week. I think they could come in and make an impact and do very well against us. That's a real thing to watch out for. Tavoris Bryant, outside linebacker, true freshman starting. You see, he's more of a safety build, bit undersized, but he'll start at outside linebacker. John Harris, good solid middle linebacker with a lot of speed. He's from Clairton. So again, local Pittsburgh area, same high school as Tyler Boyd and players of that nature. So local area guy. Joe Harrell from Warren, PA, probably maybe the best player on their defense. Fantastic outside linebacker from Warren, PA, so Northwestern PA, a couple hours north of Pittsburgh. Jarrett Lowe at corners, very good with decent speed. Nick Peterson from Latrobe, solid player. So they have guys that can cover our guys. I mean, 86 and 83 corners, nothing to shake a stick at. Anthony Frazier's decent as well. I don't think we have a supreme edge in talent here. I mean, we definitely are the more talented team, but it's not overwhelming like you expect. It's basically one of those things, you look at our players, we might have an 88 or a 90 overall guy, and they have an 85 or an 84 overall guy. So it's not this huge gulf in talent. It's enough that at every position, it's a bit of a change. Whitehall, PA, their guy, Brooks Lloyd, Baldwin High School product. It's not like they're terrible. So it's one of those things that it's going to be an interesting game, interesting to see how it shakes out. We really just have to limit the mistakes. If the Panthers can protect the football, they're more than likely going to come away with a victory here. If they can't protect the football and have a turnover differential similar to what we saw against Tennessee last week, then Pitt's really going to be in trouble. So let me know this week, who do you think is going to be the star player for the Panthers? Who's going to make the big impact? Who should be starting at quarterback? Do you like A.C. Reese or do you like C.J. Kirk? Who could be an impact player for Temple? Plus, who's going to win some of those big games around the country? Georgia, South Carolina, Tennessee, Texas A&M, UCLA, Washington. Who's going to come out victorious in those games? Let me know. As always, guys, thank you so much for watching. Hail to Pitt. We'll see you soon. Take care. Bye-bye.